Buonasera, benvenuti alla Casa Italiana Zerilli-Marimò della New York University. We are delighted to have the possibility to have with us here tonight Aldo Cazzullo, that is one of the most prominent editorialists and commentators for Corriere della Sera. And Aldo started working at La Stampa, and that is the newspaper of Turin. He's originally from Alba in Piedmont, and has been at Corriere della Sera after that. And alongside his activity as a journalist, where he writes about international politics, about Italian politics, and about a variety of different issues, he has a keen interest in Italian history and Italian identity. And he has published now more than 10 books on these topics. And there is a fil rouge, there is something that connects these books. And it's really an ongoing question about who are the Italians? When were they made like this? Who made them, or what made them, or what historical events made them? And in answering these questions, we saw that the last three books in particular that we have here, Viva l'Italia, La guerra dei nostri nonni, and Possa il mio sangue servire, make a sort of a trilogy in which Aldo tries to answer some of the questions that I gave you through fundamental moments in the history of Italy. The Risorgimento, the process of Italian unification, the Great War, World War I, really is the moment in which Italy is put to the test as a nation to challenge the infamous sentence of Prince Metternich that Italy was nothing but a geographic expression, and to demonstrate in blood and sweat that it existed as a people, as a nation. And then obviously the resistance, and this is what the last book is about, the resistance against fascism that represents a sort of second Risorgimento, according to Menor, the completion of the Risorgimento that had not been completed. Of course, these are all historiographical topics that had hundreds of books written and that have been particularly at the center of a very vibrant and sometimes not very productive ideological polemic in Italy. And that's the problem that we have had in the reading of our history and of our identity. That ideology came in very often, both from the left and from the right, not contributing to a better understanding of who the Italians are, but in providing an ideological reading of who the Italians are. Aldo Cazzullo does nothing of that kind. He tells stories of people. His books are full of protagonists. Some of them are very well known. Some of them I have never heard of, and you probably have never heard of them either. And he digs their stories out of the cemetery of memory that is history on some level and makes them alive. And he let them speak to you. He let their stories tell you what they believed in, what were their projects, what were their hopes. And then it's up to you to decide whether their hopes, their projects, their dreams were fulfilled or not. Along with these three books, there is one in the middle that is not strictly historical, but I want to mention it because we were talking with Aldo, and it seems particularly in tune with one of the things we're doing here at the Casa. And the title is Basta Piangere, Enough Crying. And if you remember last year, and I see Maria Teresa here, we started a series called Eppur si muove. We stole the famous sentence that Galileo Galilei uttered, apparently, when he was somehow let go by the Inquisition, and talking about the earth, he said, and yet it moves, even if he was forced to retract that sentence. We borrowed that from Galileo, and we wanted to refer it to Italy, in the sense that Eppur si muove, that despite all the criticism and the self-complaining that as a people we love to indulge in, something is moving. And with Maria Teresa, we talked about startups and technology and the presence of young Italian entrepreneurs in that field. And we had the mayor of Naples that came and talked about the experience in Naples, where there is this sort of political experience that has nothing to do with the common political parties. So many different signs of a country that, even if it's old historically and young as a nation, as we said, still moves. And Basta Piangere is very much in this direction of enough of the narrative of lament and of complaining, and let's start to be more productive. And as you can tell, there is a connection between the historical books that we are discussing tonight and the more presently political and engaging book that Aldo presented. I'm going to be on stage, but Aldo is going to have a speech. He's going to tell you stories. That's what we agreed on, that we wanted to hear these stories and make them alive also in New York. And I managed to interrupt him a few times. Please welcome Aldo Cazzullo.
Thank you, Stefano. Thank you to all of us.
To all of you.
Sorry. Dal diario di guerra di Silvio D'Amico. I believe the translation. In un reggimento di fanteria avviene un'insurrezione. Si tirano colpi di fucile. Si grida: non vogliamo andare in trincea. Il colonnello ordina un'inchiesta, ma i colpevoli non sono scoperti. Allora comanda che siano estratti a sorte 10 uomini e siano fucilati. Ma i fatti erano avvenuti il 28 del mese e il giudizio fu pronunciato il 30. Il 29 del mese erano arrivati i complementi, uomini inviati a colmare i vuoti aperti dalle battaglie. Si domanda al colonnello: ma dobbiamo imbussolare anche i nomi dei complementi? Essi non possono aver preso parte al tumulto del 28, sono arrivati il 29. Il colonnello risponde: imbussolate tutti i nomi. Su 10 uomini da fucilare, 2 degli estratti sono arrivati il 29 e non possono essere colpevoli di nulla. All'ora della fucilazione la scena è feroce. Uno dei 2 complementi, entrambi di classi anziane, è svenuto. Ma l'altro, bendato, cerca col viso da che parte sia il comandante del reggimento, chiamando a gran voce: signor colonnello, signor colonnello! Si fa un silenzio di tomba. Il colonnello deve rispondere: che c'è, figliuolo? L'uomo bendato grida: signor colonnello, io sono della classe del 75. Io sono padre di famiglia, io il giorno 28 non c'ero, in nome di Dio. Risponde paterno il colonnello: figliuolo, io non posso sapere tutti quelli che c'erano e che non c'erano. La nostra giustizia fa quello che può. Se tu sei innocente, Dio ne terrà conto. Confida in Dio.
Entering into World War I was for Italy a mistake, and maybe a crime. Decimations, hopeless attacks. In all the Great War, there were just 7 episodes of machine gunners who stopped shooting the enemies because they have a pity of them. The first episode happens in Turkey, in Gallipolis. A Turkish officer orders to his men to save the lives of Australian GI. There is a movie about it by Peter Weir with a young Mel Gibson. The other 6 episodes happen on Italian front. Austrian machine gunners stop shooting the Italians. The best known episode is told by Emilio Lussu in Un anno sull'altipiano, maybe the best book ever written by an Italian about World War I. There is an Austrian chaplain who cries in a very poor Italian Stop, please, good Italian soldiers, go back. Don't let yourselves be killed like this. But why? Six out of seven episodes happen on Italian front. Because Austrians were good? I don't think so. My grandfather was made prisoner. He risked dying of hunger. 100,000 Italian prisoners died of hunger in Austrian camps, also because Italy was the only state that forbid to the families to send food to the prisoners considered as deserters. My grandfather was saved by a guard who pulled up the net of the camp to let him and his friends to get some potatoes and not to die of hunger. But my grandfather didn't love Austrians. When I was a child and when I misbehaved, my grandfather told me, "US, you are as bad as an Austrian." Bosnians, in particular, were very strong, very cruel in fighting. And Bosnians wore the fez. When our grandfathers saw soldiers with the fez, some often they surrendered. The Austrian generals saw this and forced all their troops, Poles, Slovenians, Slovakians, Czechs, to wear fez. No, Austrians weren't good. But our generals, Italian generals, led the war in an obtuse way, sometimes in a criminal way. General Andrea Graziani gunned a GI, Alessandro Ruffini, only because he saluted him without taking his pipe off of his mouth. After the war, General Graziani was pushed off a moving train by unknown hands. But we have also to say that some Italian officers died together with their soldiers, and sometimes in place of their soldiers. A day, a group of Alpini, mountain troops, had to conquer a peak along a path where just one person at a time could pass. And it was enough an Austrian sniper to kill all the Italians. The officer calls the general quarter and asks the permission to stop the attack. They answer, "How many dead men you have?" "Already 30. So few, go ahead." But in the meanwhile, Austrians put a machine gun, and now there is a bundle of bodies. Alpini who attack have to climb the bodies of their fellow soldiers. Again, the officer asks the permission to stop the attack. Again, the permission is refused. Then he tells his attendant, "It's my turn." He goes out alone of the trench. He lets himself be killed. And finally, the attack is suspended because there is no more the officer in charge. To survive in the trenches, among mud, blood, rats, typhus, you had to say to yourself, "I'm not here, I am elsewhere." You had to come out of yourself. And not all were able to come back into themselves, and they went crazy. There were no cures for them. There were no names to call, to define their illnesses. And we called them scemi di guerra, war madmen, and the madhouses filled up with them. There was in the madhouse of Teramo a young man, a young GI, Angelo, who spent all the day counting. 1, 2, 3, 4. And the doctor asked him, "What are you counting?" And he answered, "Can't you see? I'm counting the bodies, the dead men." He was the GI charged to count the bodies after the attacks, and he went crazy. He came out of himself and he wasn't able to come back. In the same madhouse, there was a woman, Angela, who said she saw the Virgin Mary who foresaw the end of the war. All the people of her village came to her house to see the Virgin Mary, and the mayor closed her in the madhouse. It's April 1917. It takes 1 month to the apparitions of Fatima, where the Virgin Mary foresaw the end of the war. It was a terrible test for Italy, the World War I. But Italy passed that test. We were a young nation, 50 years old. We didn't know each other. We didn't understand each other. A soldier from Naples didn't understand a soldier from Turin. A soldier from Venice didn't understand a soldier from Sicily. But Italy could have been destroyed. It demonstrated to be a granted fact. Not a geographical expression, as Prince Metternich said, but a nation. I believe that the most meaningful story is the story of a man, of a poet, Giuseppe Ungaretti. Giuseppe Ungaretti loved Italy, but he had never been in Italy. He was born in Egypt, Alexandria. He studied in Paris. Only with in an Italian uniform, he feels himself as in the cradle of his father. And he writes a poem, I Fiumi, The Rivers, where he talks about the rivers of his life, the Serchio, where his parents were born, the Nile, where he was born, the Seine in Paris, where he recognized himself as a poet, and the Isonzo, the river of the war, where he recognized himself as an Italian. Ungaretti was a volunteer. He followed an officer course, but he didn't pass it. He was judged inadequate for command. He was 30. He made all the war as GI, together with the 18 years old GI who adored him, who carried his pack back during the marches. And a day after a long march, Giuseppe Ungaretti was tired and fell to the ground. An officer passed by, and Ungaretti didn't salute him. But that officer didn't gun Ungaretti. He was curious, and he asked him, "Who are you?" Ungaretti answered, "I am a poet." And the officer said, "You are a poet. Which kind of poem do you write?" And Ungaretti took a page out of his pocket. The officer read, "Mi illumino d'immenso. I shine from immensity. Si sta come d'autunno sugli alberi le foglie. We are leaves on autumn trees. Di queste case non è rimasto che qualche brandello di muro. Di tanti che mi corrispondevano non è rimasto neppure tanto, ma nel cuore nessuna croce manca. È il mio cuore il paese più straziato." It's too difficult for me to translate in English. It's an Italian version of the Westland. And the officer was surprised. He said, "But you are really a great poet. Did you write other poems?" And Ungaretti took other pages with handwritten poems out of his pockets. He gave them to the officer. The officer got a license, came back home, published them, and thanks to this lucky circumstance, now we can read the poems by Giuseppe Ungaretti.
Aldo, this is my first interruption. I love the story about Ungaretti, of course, the rivers, and the fact that he considered himself an Italian. He was born in Egypt, and he was raised and educated in Paris. And it's not unusual that a sense of a national identity comes to us from poetry, from literature. Actually, for centuries, that was the only venue where there was some idea that Italians were Italians. It was a literary idea, a res publica literarum, a nation of letters. And I love the fact that you picked Ungaretti as one of the soldiers of World War I that discovers his own being Italian while in the trenches. So this brings us from the Great War all the way back to the Rinascimento, to the great name of the poets that we normally associate with the first embryonal idea of an Italian identity. Are we reading too much in what Dante Machiavelli wrote about Italy, or do you think that they really had a sense of a cultural identity of the people living in the peninsula?
Ai servo Italia di dolore ostello, nave senza nocchiero in gran tempesta, non donna di province, ma bordello. Dante talked about Italy 5 centuries before Italy became a state. Italy became a state only in the middle of the 19th century. But Italy existed already. Italy is different by France or England or Spain. Italy wasn't born from politics, diplomacy, wars. Italy was born from culture, literature, art, from Dante, Giotto, Machiavelli, Michelangelo, Leonardo, Raffaello. It was not the Risorgimento movement. We can translate it rebirth of a nation, or resurrection of a nation. It was not the Risorgimento to make Italy. It was Italy to make Risorgimento. Normally we say Risorgimento was made by the rich men, by the intellectuals, by the students. It's not true. There are also common people in the Risorgimento. We are a self-deprecating people. We tell our history as a long series of failures. Counter-reform without reform. Incomplete Risorgimento movement. Mutilated victory, World War I. Betrayed resistenza, we will talk about it. Proletarians without revolution. No, it's not true there are no common people in Risorgimento. In 1848, all Italian cities rised up against the Austrians, against the sovereigns, and the rich people would not have been enough to defeat occupation armies. The most interesting case is Venice. Venice was occupied by an army composed of Croatians and soldiers from Veneto, the region of Venice, who didn't love Venetians, who kept them under their feet for centuries. The arsenal of Venezia rises up. The arsenal was led by a Croatian boss, a cruel man. Every time the workers asked him a raise in salary, he answered, maybe next time. The workers rise up, beat him to death. He asks for a priest. Guess what the workers answer him? Maybe next week. The soldiers have the order to shoot. And then the miracle happens. Italian soldiers refuse to shoot other Italians. At that moment, the Republic of Venice was reborn. But the leader, a Jewish intellectual, Daniele Manin, didn't choose the old, the ancient flag, the glorious flag with the lion of St. Mark. He chose the Italian flag, green, white, red, with a small lion of St. Mark in the corner. It means that the two fatherlands can stay together, the small fatherland, Venice, and the common fatherland, Italy. It's true also today. I'm sure that the Italians are more close to Italy than they believe to be. If you see the most famous soccer match in the history, Italy-Germany 4-3, you will see that the players don't sing the national anthem. And the anchorman, the speaker, doesn't stay quiet. It was the spirit of the time. National anthem wasn't considered important. Now it is. The national flag, until not long ago, the national flag was considered as the symbol of extreme right ideology. After Northern League denigrated it, now the national flag is respected by the great majority of Italians. And also women had an important role in the Risorgimento movement. But the real appearance of women in history is World War I. Women were nurses, women were spies, as Luisa Zeni. Luisa Zeni was sent to Austria 2 days before Italy entered into the war. The danger was terrible. In fact, Luisa was stopped at the border. Luisa had a bag with a spy kit, invisible ink to write messages, reactant to read them, and a manual to decipher them. She was stopped, but she was smart enough to put her bag on the desk of the officer, of the Austrian officer who stopped her, who wasn't smart enough to open the bag. And he let her pass, so she was able to send messages to Italian general quarter. There are German troops, there is the artillery. And when she was discovered, she was able to escape disguised as a man. Many women disguised themselves as a man to fight the war. An Austrian woman, Victoria Sachs, was discovered and was decorated as an heroine. An Italian woman, Luisa Ciaffi, was discovered and sent back home with a reprimand. But women who stayed at home took the place of the men, and they demonstrated to be able to do the same things of men, sometimes better than men. when first women male instead of men male were seen, my newspaper, Corriere della Sera, our newspaper, Massimo, wrote that the curiosity would have led women to read the mail before delivering it. It didn't happen. Women worked hardly in the fields, and agriculture production remained the same. Women worked in the factories. Some of them died because of the poisoned fumes of ammunition factories. Many of them kept up with the rhythm of factory work. They assumed men attitudes. They cut their hair short. They go out alone at night. They drink, they smoke. There was also a small sexual revolution at the beginning of the Great War in Italy, because the war separated couples and created new couples. And so hundreds of children were born out of wedlock. And also the priests fell in love. 350 priests were suspended, and there were just the ones who had been found out. The church and the generals didn't like it, and they opened the I bordelli di guerra, the war brothels, where everything became terrible with the guards at the door and with the sentences on the wall, coitus has to be short. Women were also the victims of the war. When Germans and Austrians broke Italian front in Caporetto, October 1917, they were masters of a piece of Italy for a year. Many rapes were committed. 9 months after Caporetto, the first babies were born, and they didn't know how to put them because orphanages refused them. They weren't orphans, they were the mothers, but the men of the family refused to claim the son of the Germans, the son of the war, and the babies died. And so they opened an institute close to Venice to claim them, but they died of hunger because there was not the milk. And so the mothers came in secrecy to feed the babies who they had brought in their tummies for 9 months. And 59 women were able to convince the husbands to take the baby back. We will nurture him as if he were our own. Other babies died, other babies were saved, until the director of the institute wrote a letter to the mothers to say, thank you, but now don't come here anymore, because the children grew up and they want to come out with you. It was terrible, but I'm sure that Italy would not have won the war without Italian women. In fact, Italian women had the legal capacity only in 1919, after the end of the war. Before, Italian women couldn't sign a contract without the permission of the husband or of the father. But in 1919, it was impossible not to recognize this right, because women had supported the country. And Italian women could vote for the first time in 1946, because Italian women had a very important role in the resistenza, in the resistance against the Nazis and the fascists to conquer freedom and democracy.
I like the part that you dedicate to women in your book, especially on World War One, but also in the resistance. It's and as we know, the history of women is another history that is very rarely been told. Only very recently, people have started bringing out these role models on many levels. So basically, in World War I, they find an identity that they never had. They start doing jobs that they had no access to before, and they keep them, even when their men come back. What is the difference between the women that are participating on the home front? You write beautiful pages on the Croce Rossine, on the first women going to war, somehow not very well accepted by the high officers that see this as an interference, as the female presence might have some sort of demoralizing effect on the troops. And what is the role of women in the resistance, where they are active, still in a position of subordination. As Croce Rossine, they are given the grades of high officers, otherwise they would not be respected. In the resistance, they need to fight for their own grades. Nobody's going to put mostrine and stars on their shoulders. What changes between World War One and the resistance in terms of the women presence, the women participation in these fundamental moments in the history of Italy?
Yeah, it's an important question, because fascism had a terrible idea of women. Women had to stay at home to make children, not to deal with politics, with public life. But with the resistance, we find Italian women in arms, just like in World War One. I believe resistance is a victim of a fraud, of an ideological fraud. Resistance, I prefer to say it in Italian, resistenza, it's most familiar to me. Resistance doesn't belong to a party. It belongs to the people. It doesn't belong to a faction, it belongs to a nation. Resistance was made by partisans, communist, socialist, Catholic, royalist, but resistance was made by civilians, by women, by priests, by nuns, by Jews, by carabinieri, policemen, by the prisoners of war. 600,000 prisoners of war preferred to stay in German lagers, where 80,000 of them died of hunger, rather than coming back to Italy and fighting with the Germans against other Italians. Resistance was made by women. Women as Cleonice Tomassetti, a cleaning lady, very simple woman. She had a baby, and the rich man in Rome thought to be able to do what they wanted with her. So she escaped, she joined the resistance. She was made prisoner together with 42 prisoners, all men. If you Google her name, Cleonice Tomassetti, you will see her picture. She's a beautiful young lady with elegant dresses. But those dresses aren't hers. They were the dresses of the wives of other prisoners who gave them to her to let her to go to her death with dignity. Resistenza was made by the priests. Priests as Don Ferrante Bagiardi, when he saw the Nazis gain 82 of his parishioners, he chose to die with them, saying, "I accompany you to the Lord." The same choice was made by another priest, Don Ernesto Camurati, of a small village in Piemonte, Villa Deati. The Major Meyer of SS, a cruel man, took 10 prisoners. Don Ernesto offered his life to save the lives of his parishioners. Major Meyer pushed him in the group and he gunned everyone. A partisan of the village, Bartolomeo, saw it and said and told other parishioners, when everything will be over, I will come back here, I will bring here Major Meyer, and we will have justice. Resistenza was made by nuns. 30 Italian nuns are just among the nations because they saved hundreds of Jews. Nuns like Suor Teresina, who founded a camp hospital after the battle in Rome, Porta San Paolo, where Italian people tried to stop Germans. There is an Italian soldier dying. There is a German soldier who took out his necklace. Suor Teresina took her crucifix and hits him on the head with it. The German soldier took his machine gun. Then he understood he was committing another crime, and he went away. Then when fascists and Nazis were defeated on April the 25th, began hard days, days of reckoning. Mario Sironi, the great painter, fascist of the first and of the last hour, tried to escape to Switzerland with his dog. He was stopped by a group of partisans led by Gianni Rodari, the poet. General Dari asked the identity documents, and he read Sironi Mario. And he asked him, "Are you the painter of the suburbs?" Sironi answered, "Yes, I am." And Gianni Rodari didn't want to kill a great Italian artist, and told him, "You can go, you're free." But Sironi said, "No, at the next checkpoint, I will find partisans who don't love modern art, and they will kill me." So Gianni Rodari wrote a pass in the name of Sironi Mario and saved his life. Major Meyer was captured by a woman, Dea Rota. He was closed in jail. Bartolomeo, the partisan from Villa Deati, took him in custody. He brought him to Villa Deati. He went to the parishioners of Don Ernesto. He said, "I kept my promise. Major Meyer is here. Hurry up." Days of reckoning. What I would like to save of the spirit of April 25th, I found it, the spirit, in a letter written by a woman, Enrica. Enrica was an anti-fascist. He was captured, he was closed in jail, and deported to Germany. Before being deported, he wrote a first letter to his father to say, "Dad, don't be afraid. We will see each other again." And she was right. She survived the lager. After April 25th, her boyfriend, who had fought with the American army, many Italian people fought with the American army, the Fifth Army, took a jeep, went to Germany, found her, brought her back, married her. We can say they lived happily ever after, because Enrica is still alive. She's 100 years old. I met her. And in this letter, I will read as the end of our conversation. I thank you very much, Stefano Albertini. I thank all the people of Casa Italia, and I thank you very much, all of you. I was proud to talk about my country in here in New York. And in this letter, Enrica expresses the spirit of April 25th. He writes, "Dad, Italy is in pieces, I know, but we will rebuild it. We are not afraid. We are young. We are not afraid of the future. Bright days will attend us, await us. We were happier 71 years ago with a destroyed country than now. But I think that every generation has a war to fight. 100 years ago, our grandfathers and our grandmothers won World War I. 71 years ago, our fathers and our mothers won the Liberation War. Now we and our children have another war to fight, the war against the lack of faith, the war against the resignation, the war against the moral decline of our country. Possa il mio sangue servire per ricostruire l'unità italiana e riportare la nostra terra a essere onorata e stimata nel mondo intero. May my blood be useful to rebuild Italian unity and bring our country back to be respected by all the world." I found this sentence in another letter written by a captain of Italian army who became a leader of the resistance and was gunned by the fascists. For this reason, I think it's important to save the voices of men and women of resistance and of World War I, because it's important that our young men and women know that not so long ago existed Italians, men and women, many women, for whom Italy was a serious thing, because Italy is a serious thing, for whom Italy was an ideal worthy of their lives. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I look for the letter of Enrique. Bye, Enrique. Babbino caro, quante cose vorrei dirti. Sono ancora così stordita dagli avvenimenti che tutto mi sembra un sogno. Il 29 aprile le truppe americane sono entrate in Aichach, nel lager, dove si trova il nostro carcere, e noi siamo state liberate. Noi italiane siamo 12, tutte politiche, amiche e compagne, con le quali ho passato insieme il lungo periodo di carcere. È una grande famiglia e ci amiamo come sorelle. Puoi immaginare come siamo felici dopo tante giornate dure. Babbino mio tanto caro, presto ci riabbracceremo e mi sembra un sogno. Il pensiero vostro e della nostra Italia non mi ha mai abbandonato un istante. Non essere in pensiero per me. Ho superato la prova del carcere brillantemente, il fisico buono e il morale altissimo. Abbiamo sofferto tanta fame, ma ora abbiamo più del necessario e poi di fronte a tanta sofferenza la mia piccola diventa ben poca. Abbiamo saputo come in Italia abbiate sofferto, ma abbiamo saputo anche che i nostri partigiani hanno liberato il nord Italia e questo ci ha riempito di orgoglio. Puoi immaginare come ogni notizia che venga dall'Italia sia per noi benedetta. Sapessi come ora per ora, minuto per minuto, il mio cuore era sempre accanto a voi e accanto a voi avrei voluto vivere i momenti duri di lotta e di sacrificio, accanto a voi vivere le ore indimenticabili della liberazione. Ma presto ritorneremo e potrò riprendere il mio lavoro. Tanto ci sarà da lavorare in Italia, ma non ci sgomenta. Lavoreremo e ricostruiremo la nostra vita e non ci sarà gioia più grande. Siamo giovani e l'entusiasmo non ci manca. Vedi, anche nei momenti più tristi, in carcere, la serenità e la fede, una grande fede nell'avvenire, non mi hanno mai abbandonata. Ed ora, al pensiero di essere presto tra voi, carissimi, alla fede si unisce la gioia e la certezza di giorni luminosi che ci attendono. Babbino caro, saluta tutti gli zii e cugini per me, ricordami gli amici e compagni che sono per me più che fratelli. Presto ci riabbracceremo e giorni luminosi e belli ci attendono. Ti abbraccio forte forte e ti bacio. Enrique. Grazie.
For Aldo Cazzullo, now the floor is open. He touched on so many different topics and stories that are all intermingled and intertwined. So if you have comments or questions, yes, ma'am.
My English is poorer than the Italian of the Austrian chaplain who say cries stop, but I try to answer to you. We had the Northern League. Now the Northern League changed her mind and her speech is more anti-Europe, just like Marine Le Pen in France. But until a few years ago, Northern League was tried to separate the North from the rest of Italy. But there is also in the South, not a league, not yet. I'm sure that the Southern League will born maybe in the next years. But there is also in the North, in the South, a feeling that I can express so. Like this, the fault of our problems is not ours, it's of other Italians. At the north, many people say we could live like in Germany, happy and rich, if if there is not the south. But at the south, there are people who say we could live happily if. The North, a century and a half ago, would have not conquered the South and made the South poor. But you can understand that they really say the same thing. the fault of our problems is not ours, is of other Italians. It's very dangerous. It's dangerous because if the fault of our problems is not ours, we can do nothing to solve the problems. Italy now is not happy. We arrived to consider that being Italian is an unlucky fact. It's terrible, because it's not true. When abroad I say I am Italian, I always meet people who smile to me, who would say to be Italians, but to wear Italian dresses, to drink Italian wines, to eat Italian food, to come to Italy for studying, for visiting the country, for working in the country. It's incredible, the difference of perception of Italy abroad and in the country. I'm trying with in my what I can do a few things, but I'm trying with my books to contribute to restore the self-confidence, the faith in ourselves, because I'm sure that as Italians we can do yet many things. We can be proud to be Italian. In every day, our newspapers, La Repubblica, Corriere della Sera, we had to write many stories of Italian people who may make us unproud, ashamed to be Italians. But we could also tell stories, more stories about people who can make us proud to be Italians. For example, the Italian soldiers in the peacekeeping missions abroad, that are considered, I don't say the best in the world, but good soldiers, because they are able to listen to the local people, they respect the local people, because they are they bring the heritage of the great lesson of the Christian culture and the humanistic culture. But also the heritage for which Italy is important in the world.
Aldo, and before you seem to mention that the renewed interest and love for the Italian flag, the Italian anthem, in your interpretation could even be explained as a reaction to that phase in the political activities of the Northern League, when they were burning the flag, where they would refuse to stand up during the singing of the anthem. So, on some level, when they try to touch these symbols that for many years were put aside because they were considered a sort of right-wing, pseudo-fascist heritage, was brought back as a reaction to the Northern League putting into question these symbols of national unity.
You're right. I believe then Italians who love Italy should thank the Northern League, because with the deprecating, the denigration of the flag, of the national anthem, helped to restore the feeling of the fatherland. And I talk about the national anthem, the national flag. I could talk also about the Vittoriano. Normally, Americans who came to Rome love Vittoriano, because it's very. In Italy, we denigrated always it. But it's important to read the sentences.
It's the big monument to Victor Emmanuel, bright white marble in Rome. It's the only bright white monument in Rome, and it has several funny nicknames in Rome.
Yes, many nicknames: wedding cake.
Typewriter.
Exactly. But it's important, not only the sculptures, very beautiful, but also two sentences sculpted in the marble in Latin, Patriae Unitati and Civium Libertati, to the unity of fatherland and to the freedom of civilians, of citizens. Patriae Unitati, because Risorgimento, this monument was built after the Risorgimento movement as the tomb for the king who made Italy, and also to remember all the people dead in the Risorgimento wars. And now there is the milite ignoto, unknown soldier, beard in the monument. Patria Unitati, because the Risorgimento movement is the moment where Italy became a state, got its independence, its independence, its unity. Civium Libertati, because the Risorgimento movement is the moment where Italy defeats the sovereigns, the ghettos, the news, the power of the Pope, of the priests. It's the beginning of the civil rights that, with the time, with the resistance against the fascism and the Nazism, we will conquer only in 1946. Only 70 years ago, women, Italian women, could vote for the first time. And when I think to Vittoriano, I think also to the unknown soldier. The unknown soldier was chosen by a woman, an old woman, the mother of Antonio Bergamas. Antonio Bergamas was a Jew of Nova Gorizia, close to Trieste, an Austrian soldier. He should be an Austrian soldier, but he, just like other 2,000 soldiers, deserted and chose to fight with the Italian army against the Austrian army. So he chose the death. Also, if they didn't die in fight, when they were made prisoner, they were shot, no? Or hanged, like Cesare Battisti. And in a letter written to his mother, he explained the reason why he deserted the Austrian army to fight with the Italians. And he wrote, I didn't want to die, but if I have to die, I don't want to die fighting for Austria, for the empire. I want to die fighting for my really fatherland, Italy, on my land, on my carso, with your name on my mouth, mother. Antonio Bergamas died in the war, and her mother, Maria, was charged to choose the unknown soldier who now rests in Vittoriano in Rome. They brought her in a church with 11 coffins of unknown soldiers like her son. He had a black veil, and he took out of her head the black veil, and she put it on the second coffin. So the man of ceremony said to her, okay, told her, you can go. But she wanted to salute also the other soldiers, just like to ask pardon, to say, I'm sorry, I didn't choose you. And at the end, at the 11th coffin, she fell to the ground because of the she was moved, but insomma, si riprese, come si può dire.
She came back to her senses.
She lived a long life. She voted for the first time in 1946. She died in 1953, and now she rests in the Aquileia Cathedral, close to other 10 unknown soldiers.
Yes.
I was wondering, we didn't really speak any about the first book, Viva l'Italia, the Risorgimento and Resistenza. I'd like if you could speak a little bit about the first book.
Yes, but I am from Turin. You know, Turin was the only Italian state in Piemonte. And the king who made Italy, Vittorio Emanuele II, was the king of Piemonte. And I read a letter written by him. He is fully forgot in Italy. Nobody talks about him. I wrote a letter written by him to his attendant. I leave Turin to fight with the army against Austrians. If the army is defeated, you can leave all the treasures, or the gold, the paintings, the money. But you have to know that in the museum there are four flags, Austrian flags, conquered by my father, Carlo Alberto, in the first war of independence. Please save those flags. I want to find again them, just like my sons. This is the only thing I ask you. It was, the meaning was, we also, if we are defeated, we will go on fighting for the freedom and independence of Italy. I like this. I'm writing a new book about women. The title is Le donne erediteranno la terra, because I'm sure that this will be the century of women, the century where women will overpass men. And in a Risorgimento, there are many women. Sometimes they have to disguise themselves as a man, because to get freedom, women should become men, or should look like a man. Colomba Antonietti, for example, fought in the defense of a Roman Republic. In 1848, 1849, Rome became a republic. The Pope should leave, and the Roman people, together with the patriots, came from all over Italy, particularly from Liguria, from Genoa. Mazzini was from Genoa. Mameli, who wrote our national anthem, was from Genoa. Saffi, I believe, was from Giuseppe Garibaldi was from Nizza. Nizza was Italian, was Liguria. Now Nizza is France. And Colomba Antonietti got married with what was a woman of the people, and she married an aristocratic who was closed in jail because the law doesn't permit to an aristocratic to marry a woman of the people. And Colomba, because of her husband was made prisoner because of their love, chose to fight against the French army until to her death. And she died fighting, and everyone thought, also Garibaldi thought it was a man. But she lost her bonnet, hat, and everyone discovered she was a woman. For example, also Cristina Belgioioso, she was an aristocratic woman, she dressed as a man to fight. Rose Montmasson, the wife of Francesco Crispi, was one of the 1,000 of Garibaldi who liberated Sicily, and her husband repudiated her to become a minister, and he married another woman, and she died poor and alone. There are many stories of women. I'm trying to tell them because it's important. I believe I have a daughter who will come to America next month to study at the Columbia University. And I will bring also to New York University. I am very proud to be Italian. I consider that we can be proud of our story, of our women, of our men. I repeat, we are self-deprecating people. But it's important to tell stories also of scandals and corruption. We have to denounce everything, opporte tut, scandal avenient, but we have also the duty to tell the truth about our history. And we can be proud of our history. We can be proud to be Italian.
Thank you, Aldo. And I think with this message, it's time for us to go. And I would like to thank again Aldo Cazzullo for having shared with us his stories, his thoughts, and his vision of Italy, both in the past and in the future. And it's an open invitation to come back. He's a very prolific author, so I'm sure in the future new books are not going to be missing. And there are a few copies of the three books we discussed tonight upstairs, and Aldo will be happy to sign them for you. Thank you all again very much. Grazie, Aldo.
Thank you.